All right, thank you. Yeah, today we'll be talking about design tokens in WordPress. Quick overview, I'm going to talk about what are tokens and why you'd want to use them. We're going to do a little bit of a technical deep dive into Figma and WordPress, but I promise you there won't be a quiz, like stay with it. I think it's going to be, hopefully it's valuable to you and your projects. And then briefly touch on a little bit about like what the future Figma and WordPress looks like with tokens in, with fully functional tokens. So I'm Mike Henderson. I'm a web developer at NewCity. I do mostly WordPress work. I've been in higher education. I was at a higher education university at for like over 13 years and then jumped into the agency space. I wanted to share a quick story too, because like WPCampus is very core to like us moving from our ancient CMS into a WordPress system. So I just wanted to thank WPCampus and it's this learning community is just awesome. And without that help, like I would not have been able to do that project at my old university. So I'm also Sarah Andrew, our art director at NewCity. She's been with NewCity for over 25 years. Is going to join us later from a video, and she's going to walk through some Figma stuff. And it's really been cool to like collaborate with Sarah on this project and or across multiple projects, like experimenting with this new idea of like increasing this collaboration between the two disciplines. So what are design tokens and why might you use them? So a design token is basically a nickname for any kind of attribute that you have in your design. A designer is going to like choose these tokens and create them and apply them to their designs. And the developers are going to use them and build out with the token. These values apply to any visual elements of our components, and they kind of like give our designs and brands a certain look and feel. So in this example, I have the famous truck sheep icon, right? Yeah. Fans of truck sheep in the room. Here I'm labeling the two blue colors. And I could actually label a lot more than that's in this picture. I could label the white, the grays, the yellow, the headlamp, even like the stroke border that outlines this icon can all be attributes that help define this element. So in a token world, I'm just simply naming these values. So instead of like having to say like 1159 BD over and over, I could just like call that primary dark, right? Or primary. So that's a simple setting up a global token. So we're just taking that raw value and assigning it a name. So anything that you can assign a value to in CSS and styles can be a token. So we're talking colors, opacity, shadows, typography, things included in that are like font family, font sizes, font weights, line heights. Our spacing in WordPress, this also translates into your margin and padding settings in the full site editor. And also included in spacing is media queries, breakpoint sizes. Borders, like I said earlier, can be a token. The radius of those, you can put icons into tokens, your grid systems, and even like animation values, right? So the main one of the main benefits of using a token is like updating it will update all the instances it's used. So back to our truck sheep example, if we wanted to switch out the color of our truck, all I have to do is like reassign these globals to these names here. So we can have like a green color and potentially change out our brandings using a token system. So this would update the value of like anywhere these primary dark and primary aliases are used. So with tokens also, you have to strike a balance about how many places they're using, and you have to be careful about like tying too many different components to the same token. So in this example, I have a button and a checkbox and a radio button, and I'm tying all of these elements to the same alias value of primary. So what happens if I want to update the checkbox color? without having to reflect what the button color is doing. So this is where we introduce the concept of map tokens. So we can switch out these values without having to affect other parts of the system. So in this example, then I'm adding this new layer of mapped tokens names here in this third column. So I'm just giving the button a surface button name, a surface checkbox name, and a surface radio name. And now I can change out those values. So I introduce a blue here and a red here, and I can switch out those values that are labeled to these particular components. And our truck shape example, again, like I'm just adding a surface cab and a surface bed color, and I can do the same, adding just this mapping layer. So aliasing and mapping tokens allow us to make things more modular. If different components are using the same color, we might want to assign them the same token, so we can update them independently. And this really just provides like a cushion in using our tokens across the system, but still using the benefits of like tying things together and the dependency is on the same name. So why do this thing? So tokens create like a simple source of truth in your design. So as a developer coming to a project, as a designer coming to a project, you can all like look at the same values and know where those are set on the project. You create a consistency in your design language. So you're using the same values, the same colors across the system, and there's no room for guessing. It creates a team engagement. So there's like a conversation that happens at the beginning of the project, between the designer and developers. And also with that engagement, we establish a shared language, like calling the same things, the same colors, like whether that's primary, secondary, different spacing sizes. It allows for a fast iteration. We found that using tokens in WordPress in this way allows us to build components much faster. And the Figma side of things, it allows our designers to reuse components and change out values faster to make to quickly iterate. And along with that too is like we have a reduced redundancy. So reusing the components again across multiple projects. So what I found as a developer too is that I outline here a basic design process. So we have a requirements step at the beginning. The project is like a discovery. We have a design, and I'm highlighting here where we typically see a developer involvement is in the development stage, the testing, and the site maintenance stage. Introducing tokens, we can move that developer involvement much earlier into the process. So we're talking with the designers even before they start designing and setting up tokens. So again, why do this? Like the tokens allow you to effectively manage your design system. You have a better handoff from design to development, and you create a highly consistent UI, which increases a user experience of the brand and just like a more enjoyable user experience. So the current state, what does the current state of the process look for us like in NewCity? So we're very early in the process, but I think it's helpful to share where we are with this. So basically I give our designer some example values that can be set in theme.json. So this is basically a dissected markdown file of things that we could consider like setting in our theme. So this includes the color palette, the font weights, the line heights, and this list is being added to as we go. So they then take that, and then there's a discovery phase where we're finding about our client's brand, any technical requirements, and then from that starter file, from the starter theme, we'll go ahead and start setting up our globals. This includes like the colors and anything that we get from the brand. And then the designer starts going into page design. And from page design, naturally components come out of that process. So again, there's another setting of globals and aliases and maps inside of that design process as things are getting componentized. And then into the development phase, when things are approved, I'm setting up tokens at the beginning of that phase. And also at the beginning of that phase, so that I can use those as I'm building out the components. All right, so I have a video from Sarah that she's gonna deep dive into Figma. If you're not familiar with Figma, it is a design tool, and she's gonna go into that with you.
And Tom and I are from NewCity. I've been working with Mike on a number of projects as we try to figure out our best strategy for using tokens in our designs. It's been kind of a rocky journey, and it's a long way to cover, but I hope telling you about other sparks and ideas for our biggest challenges has been the decision about using Token Studio or variables. Token Studio came out in 2021, and they've been improving capabilities ever since. Well, Figma released its own native variables in 2023. Since then, Figma has made considerable progress, but still lies behind Token Studio in some key areas. Our team started testing out Token Studio in 22, but we decided to switch to variables in 23. Mainly because we preferred a native approach, even if it was a bit more limited. However, we are now considering switching back to Token Studio. So while this problem, there are three main issues, but really they all boil down to one thing. Token Studio, in our opinion, currently offers a better connection between design and development. Currently, our pipeline is both non-existent, rather it's completely manual. We are dealing with a very small set of global tokens at this point, so it's doable. But it's not ideal, and it's certainly not going to be scalable. I think probably the best way to show you what I mean is with typography. I have two basic text layouts here. The one on the left was created with tokens, and the one on the right was created with variables. Tokens can be used to apply fonts, size, weight, line height, and it's just about anything else you can imagine to your design system. The biggest difference is that I can create a single token made up of multiple values in Token Studio. So I can take an H1, an H2, or paragraph, and make a typography token of it. So if you look over here, this is the Token Studio menu. And you can see I have a number of tokens here. Looking at these H1, H2, and PVM tokens, you can see that these actually have multiple values. There's a font family, there's weight, there's size, and there's line height. All of these values are also tokens, but I bundled them together into this H1 token, which can be applied as a style. In Figma, I apply the global variables, those basic values, the text styles I'm creating, through the Figma interface or the components that I'm designing. So over here we have our variables menu from Figma, and you can see I have a lot of the same values here. However, I don't have those multiple value components that I had over in Token Studio. I'm going to select my H1 here so I can show you how to do that. So you can see here that I have an H1 style applied. In Figma, and I'm actually going to detach this so we can see the values that are in it. These are our values in our H1 style, and you can see how these different tokens are in these little gray boxes. And we have font family, we have weight, font size, anything that really that has this little text component with the dot in it. If it's simple, that means you can apply a token to it. So I've used those smaller tokens to create a text style, but it's not as easily translatable to CSS and HTML as the Token Studio versions. I mean, it all works out in the end, but you end up with a style that may have five or more tokens attached to it, as opposed to a single token on the left. So the ability to create these multi-value tokens can be a pretty powerful tool. Another place where Token Studio shines in it is in its ability to include mapping tokens. One of the biggest complaints the Figma community has right now about variables is that we're limited to manual sizing. We spend way too much time setting up individual font sizes and line heights, but we usually have to do at least twice to illustrate desktop and mobile page designs. Figma handles this with modes, which can be applied to the page you're designing. So I'm going to actually expand my page here. And you can see I actually have a set of desktop values in this middle column, and I have a set of mobile values column on the right. Obviously, some of them are the same, like typography, font families, but might have different sizing, might have different line heights. So what I can do is once I have these sets and I have my different modes, I can actually apply the mode to the page that I'm working with, and those styles will adjust accordingly. Open Studio, I can create a line height multiplier instead. This allows me to control the scale by changing the base. So I'm going to look at my H1 again, which is over here. And you can see under line height, I have line height.height multiplied by 52, which is the size of this text style. My line height multipliers are down here. I have a variety of them. So if I want to have something tight, like 1.1, 1.2 for a heading, or something wider, like 0.5 for a body copy, those things can easily be applied to my different multi-value text style or typology style that I have up here. This is a very simple example, but Token Studio can do more complicated operations. It's at least a step closer to what can be done with CSS. Still a snapshot in time, but it is an improvement. Of course, this is all very nice for me as a designer. How does this become a two-way conversation with Mike? In Token Studio, I can export my tokens in a JSON file, which can be manually shared, or better yet, synced with platforms like GitHub, GitLab, and more. So if I go down to the bottom of my Token Studio menu, I have tools. Click on this, I can see export to file slash folder. There are a lot of different things I can set here. It gives me kind of a preview of what my code's going to look like when it exports. And I can save it directly to my desktop. Unfortunately, this exporting is a place where Figma really falls down at right now at this point, but I wouldn't be surprised if this changes in the next few major releases. I haven't even been able to really test this because Figma has attached the ability to sync variables to their enterprise level pricing. And while I'm on the issue of cost, syncing tokens between Figma and your development platform does require a pro upgrade using both of these systems. Token Studio is a little over $20 a month per person. An enterprise level Figma account varies depending on your current plan, but at our agency, it would be $30 or more per month per person. So because of all this, we are moving back towards Token Studio 4 now. However, I expect movement is going to continue to improve rapidly. Ideally, there will come a time when conversion between tokens and variables is possible. I hope this has been helpful and given you some insight into what tokens look like on the design side of the equation. Now I'm going to hand it back to Mike.
Thank you, Jen. All right, so thanks for that, Sarah. So what do tokens look like in WordPress? So basically we're talking theme JSON here. So if you're not familiar, theme JSON was a file added back in WordPress 5.8 that allows you to take control over styling the WordPress editor. So you can control settings available in the block editor. You can customize options available to the user. You can set your default color palettes. Define font families here, and some of your layout settings. And you can also like apply these settings per block. So it's like Sarah said, it is a manual process of setting the variables at this point, but there are some future options, which I'll go into a little bit later. So basically, I'm getting that export that she showed from that JSON file that she's exporting. And then I'm going through a thing JSON section by section, like setting these values, right? So in the color palette, in the color settings, we're concerned about the palette, the duotone, gradients, and shadow properties. So again, here's the this is a screenshot of the variables, the color variables in Figma. And so I take those variables, set the palette in theme JSON, or along with like giving it the name and the slug. And then WordPress does a translation from theme JSON into CSS variables. So you'll see here, you get a CSS variable of WP preset color, and whatever the name that I assigned to that color. So in the example here, you get that color white. Well, I'm using the we're using the base color here, and the black is labeled as contrast. And so this also sets the editor up in this way. So you get this color palette available in the text. In this example, we have a group block, and I'm setting the entire text color for the entire group block and presenting with a palette. For typography, we're concerned about font families, font sizes, and font weight and line height we're accomplishing through the custom section in theme JSON. So again, here are the font size tokens in Figma. I take those values and put them into theme.json. Theme.json for typography also has a fluid width setting. So if you remember back in the example with Sarah, she had like both a mobile and a desktop sizing. So that's how we're accomplishing the fluid back in Figma. That does a translation. And here, WordPress does a clamp for us automatically if we enable that fluid setting. So you can see all the examples of the clamps there. Again, in the editor, I have a paragraph block selected here, and I'm getting all of those named values available to me here in the typography section. For spacing, we're concerned about the spacing sizing attribute. And so again, in Figma, these are the values there. In this particular example, we're using a clamp as well in the spacing, but you have to put that in manually with CSS. And then here's the resulting CSS variable after WordPress does the translation. Again, here I'm selecting a group block, and I'm adjusting the top and bottom margin. And you can see here in the dimensions setting in the editor, you get the stepped value based on those different sizes that you set. Container width is another really important one to set. So this is your content size and your Y size in the editor. Again, this is the variable in Figma. And then in theme JSON, it's contained in the layout object. And then the variable is a little bit different here. It is WP style global. And you can see the same content size settings. And in the editor, this is displayed as the none setting. White setting and full width, you don't need to set because that is the full width of the browser. And so I just wanted to show an example too. This is a little contrived, but like I basically just stripped out all the tokens from this particular piece of CSS where I'm targeting a class. Just to show you the contrast of like, if I am going to develop a custom component in this way, this is like the manual CSS values, but like the components end up being like this. So like we're leveraging those CSS variables that WordPress sets up for us. And so it's just like a little bit of a different look in your CSS. There are some creature comforts that you kind of lose. Like I have a syntax highlighting plugin in my code editor that, you know, will make all the colors look nice and stuff. But you kind of lose that with the variables at this point until someone develops a plugin to like auto highlight those for you. So how has this like changed our process? So in the design, I think you would see a more clarity, consistency across designs, like the spacing used inside of components. It's changed like the decision making and review processes. and really just led to like a faster prototyping and iteration in the design, and also that increased collaboration because we're having conversations much earlier in the process. On the development side, it's made me more efficient in building components of WordPress, like really diving in and leaning into the site editor to build these components with patterns. And I had, it makes things more clear, like everybody's using the same spacings, like I can just use it over and over and there's not like any confusion. I also find myself like using less CSS. This probably stems from like using more and more of the site editor, but these custom components like require less custom CSS. So the challenges of this process, like these, like if Sarah mentioned, these exports have a certain pricing restrictions in some instances. And Figma also introduced like a developer mode within the last year too. It'd be really nice to see a developer mode where you can really inspect and interrogate tokens. So I'd like to see that. So like, it's not really a great interface, but if I need to go into Figma and like actually look at the variable. And then also that automation versus manual process, which Sarah mentioned, like we'd like to get to a way where like this is more automated and set up directly into the JSON, but now mostly now it's like a manual process. And learning new ways to collaborate, like it's like a file will be like set up with these tokens, but like I'll still find instances where the designer will still like use like default back to like their pixel spacing and using the system. So like what is coming in like Figma and WordPress to address some of these needs? Like these multi-value variables would be nice in Figma native. It'd be really nice if Figma learned how to do math on its own instead of using a plugin. And then we'd like to see like more import/export capabilities. Also, that dead mode viewing I think would be like a really nice add-on. Like, might have to like submit a. I don't think they have like a public ticket system for Figma, but like maybe.
Death mode is paid now too.
Yeah, there you go. So like maybe if somebody knows that someone on Figma, we can exchange information. And then on the WordPress side of things, I'd really like to get to a point of automation. There are a couple options here that are worth exploring. WP VIP has a design system bridge plugin, which I have some thoughts on, but like. What I understand they're doing is bad is that they're setting all of their tokens into the custom portion of theme JSON. And so I'd like to get more into the like using the you know the native palettes and stuff instead of like relying solely on that custom area. Also mentioned style dictionary here. Other developers in our shop from the Drupal side of things have experimented with this. And how I understand it, it's basically doing what WordPress is doing already with theme JSON. So you have a JSON file, and then you can rename your variables as that exports. Like there's like a process like of syncing up names in that way. But I think WordPress is getting really close to this component idea of working. And I think we kind of touched on it a little bit in the community group. Like the combination of block patterns, these section styles, block styles, and sync patterns, like we're just so close to a component-based system in WordPress, and it just needs a little bit to get it over the line. So I always end up saying like this, like that, like I'm really excited for the future of WordPress and in Figma, and just making these processes and our lives easier. So yeah, that's all I have for you for today. I'm happy to take questions. Or we could discuss a little bit about if you've used tokens at your institution at all, or what do you think of these ideas? Looks crazy.
So if we were starting from theme.json and not from Figma, would the transition into Figma be a lot easier than, or would it be easy? Would it not be hard? Like we already have a theme.json. It's very fleshed out.
Okay. And I think
put that in Figma. Is that just crazy?
I guess
Can I just chime in on that? I think some of our thinking was is like one, we all the color naming is in a variable sense. You know, they're not direct text codes and things. So like my ideal world is like to have like a Figma file that has basically the things you list on the second or third slide where I can give it to a designer. And basically, like if I have a whole bunch of patterns, right, that all those tokens are mapped to like whatever those patterns are, right? So then like they can just like plug in the numbers and then like they just like drag the Legos, right? And then you know, like the content strip and you have this idea, but a way that like we're all talking the same language. So like spacing's like working all like well together, like padding and alignment in this way that I think, I mean, you said it, it's like talking the same language and it's also almost getting to the point where you can just like fill this form, you know, which is basically like theme.json, right?
Yeah.
Or like the I can give it to a developer and they can be like, okay, let's boom, boom, and then they were like, you know,
yeah,
third of the way.
For us, it's like really like that initial conversation between me and the designer, like even before the project is in design, like is a really valuable thing for me. It's like we're talking the same values and like I can set up theme.json much earlier in the process and get ahead on the build a little bit, like as things are in design, because we're using the same values, right?
Instead of like, I think I oftentimes struggle with like, you know, there's a lot of print designers that are designing things in a very non-conforming way of thinking, right? So it's like, this looks good because design is pretty, right? But they're not thinking about how you keep all the spreadsheets here, not just like overriding to like match these. So I mean, it feels like it all leads really well to the design system, where how WordPress it is now.
So I'm coming from a university where our design system has to be compatible with multiple different CMSs. So it's not just WordPress that they're building things for. So I'm wondering, like it sounds like the conversation between design tokens and WordPress theme.json is really good to have and important if you know that you're going straight into WordPress, right? Because you know, right, everything that's in theme.json needs a token. Tell me what it is and then I'll put it in theme.json. It's a really good translation. But I think that designers would prefer to just design without having that conversation so that they could tokenize whatever it was that they wanted to tokenize. But I'm wondering if it's a harder translation between a random set of tokens and other products, or if there is a design token pattern that people are starting to standardize on that doesn't necessarily have to loop, like link directly to a product. So save that tokens.
Yeah, well, so once you set up those tokens in Figma, like that export, like you can take that export and put it, apply it to any product that you want, right? So like, we're doing this for Drupal. Like you could potentially do this for other systems, like hand off this file. Like that's, I think the key though is like, or the really the future work here, and there's a lot of work to do it, but is getting that automation. So like you can change things and update and not have to worry about like, you know, updating every single value you're coding. Like it just happens and that becomes part of your CI, really.
Makes sense.
Yeah.
Cool.
How far up is that?
Yeah, I mean, well, like I said, there are tools to do that are doing some of this. And I think as those, like, as we get closer to WordPress components, we can do some of that. So it's just a matter of like writing those scripts and writing those tools.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Do you factor in the CSS custom? Some variables that come in from WordPress core when you're having those naming discussions with your design team?
Yeah, so that starter markdown file is becoming bigger and bigger for each project. Like as like, oh, let's tokenize this kind of thing that's available in WordPress. Let's tokenize this. And so that process is getting more coverage of like all of the different values that are available in WordPress. Yes.
Cool. They're the ones that core ships. Even despite your theme.
Yes. So that came in like there's actually a setting in theme.json 3 now that you can like disable some of that. We actually ran into some of those bugs So if like we're talking about like the default spacing, default font that gets set in WordPress theme, or it gets set in WordPress if you don't address it in theme JSON. That's the way it used to be, but now it just gets set unless you disable it in version 3. So that's there's a dev note about that on 6.6, but I think it would be that's a good idea, because like I think it'd be valuable to know what's available there. And we had like an older project, actually the UTK project, is that it was kind of in the middle of all of that transition. And so we weren't yet tokenized in Figma, but we were like kind of using like custom variables like all over in the actual build. And so we're trying to move to just only use the token now. Don't use like the WordPress built-in spacing, but there are still patterns out there that exist with that spacing. I mean, it doesn't break anything. It's just like a little bit, it's just like there's some code cleanup that needs to happen there to like get everything to the agreed spacing that we had set. And also like the WordPress spacing too isn't really, you can't do a clamp, or it's not set with a clamp. So like we have like our other spacings that are using a clamp. So it's like a benefit of like moving to the tokens, like, you know, just get, you get a more flexible spacing at that point. I didn't see how to check online. Call.
Okay. I didn't see any last.
Okay.
Second look on your phone.
But anyway, I was worried about time, and I feel like I went a little fast.
So. All good.
But we're having a conversation. Yeah.
Yeah. So how did the conversation start? Did you decide who we're going to tokenize, and who is driving that? Was it like developer driven, design driven?
Yeah. So. It actually started with like there was some experimentation of doing it. It was on the other side of our shop, the Drupal side of our shop, is that they were looking at a complete workflow of like updating the tokens from their side, like in incorporating to the CI. And so it was like, I want to do that for WordPress, but I want to control what we get decided at first, right? So that's that conversation of like, these are things that are available in WordPress, because I want WordPress to be the source of truth instead of Figma being the source of truth. You know, so like that, yeah. So basically I was like, I saw that from the Drupal side. I was like, I think we can do this in WordPress, and I think we can do it this way. Cool. So, yeah.
How did you introduce it to your designers then? Like, how did you convince them that it was worth changing their workflow?
Yeah, I was like, I think like before, like I put together this presentation, it's gonna be, I think it's the same kind of things, is that like, hey, we're going to be on the same page much sooner. It's going to make both of our lives easier. Let's try this. And that's why I thank Sarah for, you know, going down this journey with me, and then, you know, bringing more designers on and trying these things to like see how it works. Like, you know, our process is still evolving, but I think it's been like a, if you ask her, like, I think it's been a win for us both. So just like, and it's been like a really cool collaboration too. It's just like trying to figure this thing out together. And I wanted her to get into Figma. I know that I realize that that's like a very technical design program, but like it's useful for me to, as a developer, to see like what kind of tools our designers are using. And I've been in Figma now more so, you know, because of the dev mode. I've been in Figma more, and I'm beginning to like that space a little bit more. I'm by no means a designer. But like I think it's valuable to me to see, you know, how these things are put together and what is possible in their space. You know, it helps inform what we can do on our side.
Slide presentations in Figma, is that?
Yeah, these are Figma slides. They just introduced this like a few months ago. So it's been really cool. Like, I can show you like if you want to nerd out with me, but like there's like a zoom out kind of thing. And so if you've been in Figma or like the Fig Jam, you can see everybody's cursors. Oh, wow. Like we did that with slides. Like it was just like we're creating these slides together, and we're all fully remote. So like she's in the Virginia area. So like we're like, you know, usually working on the same slides with the same cursor and like the kind of Figma experience. So it's really cool.
Is it like Prezi?
No, it's just a big
money.
You don't get like not so much whiz bang zoomy things, like But no, if you want, I can show this. So like you get this this zoomed out design view. Windows. But anyway, like you can just scroll around and zoom in here and whatever. So it's kind of cool.
Cool.
I have a question about block variations. So yeah. If you're creating like multiple variations of like what Jolene was showing this morning, but how one block can have like a number of custom variations within it, are you adding an additional value along with alias and mapped, or is it just another mapped?
Yeah, so we're not at the point in WordPress yet where we can do a lot of mapping of the tokens. Like we're mostly working with aliases at this point. Like the block variations for us are, you know, just a style, just like the CSS class eventually. And so that's where we're targeting those kind of things. Does that answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah. Have you used any of the other Figma export type options? Like for, you know, they'll give you like a block of code and you can just copy and paste that. I've always been
I've used like maybe some of the suggestions for like some of the flexboxy stuff and whatnot, just because if I didn't remember that particular property, but like, no, I haven't like taken it like piecemeal or the whole code block.
I've wondered to what extent like developers are involved in that, and is it actually like good code that it puts out, or is it just like there's been more time fixing it?
It is not.
Yeah, okay. So I was right to be leery.
It's good inside Figma. Yeah. Like it's good to get all of those things together, but just to be like export CSS, put in website.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, it's really good for inspecting, but not for actual like production use.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah, it's good for like design and sharing and prototyping and all of that. Like, we're just using it for the first time on a project, so we're figuring it out.
Have you standardized like any of your naming? Like, have you gotten to a point where like you always have primary, you always have?
Yeah, I had a slide in the presentation. I probably should have included it because I had a little bit more time. But like, it seems like a theme. Like some of these recent presentations I get is like naming things is hard. We know that as developers, but it's also hard, you know, on the design side. So I think the and it's, I feel too, there's like a different flavor when you're approaching it from a university, because like how often are you going to change like your hex color of your school's color, right? Like, but I at the same time, like I liked the name colors. Like we have like a Tennessee orange or whatever, like or Tennessee smoky. I like that name, but I think the best practices is to use like a primary, secondary, tertiary. And then also t-shirt sizing. You know, you want eventually your naming systems to be scalable and flexible in that way, so you can add in the extra slot. So you start with like the small, medium, large, and then you can add in the extra large if you need, extra small, that kind of thing. So that's, I think that's the way the industry would tell you to name those things. Yes.
How do you add stadium? Like.
Yeah.
Extra.
Yeah, you just you have to like that's hard because you need to decide. You know, as you're setting up those systems, like you need to like, well, is this going to need to scale or have a variation further in on, you know, throughout the project. So yeah, it's hard.
Yeah, we have mostly moved away from the small, medium, large because of that, because you never know when it's going to change. So we just do like number based.
Our design system makes that way too. It's a multiplier of something. So we'll go, you know, we can't use three in anything. It's like, you know, size 3 doesn't correspond to anything that we do if we're doing it wrong, because it goes from like 1, 2, 4, 8, 10, 12 per year.
Yeah, there is, I mean, I think there's opportunity to write better tooling around that too, because like I find myself so often like going back to theme JSON, like what is the actual value here, instead of like what is this medium thing mean? You know what I mean? So like there is that. So but that's what's great about tokens is like too, is that I can interrogate that particular component in Figma. And if you're using the token, they're going to use the same name that I'm used to. Instead of like having to find a pixel value, like, okay, what is that set in theme JSON? Like, well, what is the name of that variable now? So like, yeah, I'm still, I'd like to do less of that and just like get the thing built, right?
Sure.
And
so you're using base and contrast for page color.
you know, these examples we were, but like, I'll be honest, like in some of my more recent projects, I'm using the name colors, like I said, like a Tennessee orange or like a smoky, or like those are from the brand. Say that.
I do a double layer on that. I define like all of the named colors, and then I set those as my primary color variable. So
yeah.
I can always swap out the primary color, but yeah.
Yeah, nice. Yeah. So
but then you can still update if like your orange changes by, you know, it's not. Yeah, you know, it's a two at the end instead of a one or whatever. They tweaked it slightly.
Yeah,
copy that. You've got to copy that your colors.
That is the thing. Thank you all.
Any other questions?